Good morning to all of you this morning. Good to see all of you here. Just a few announcements here in the bulletin. We have the telephone number again in the bulletin that will help you to remember not to block it. But that will be the number for the church or from the church or from which you will receive information from the church. So as I've stated before, if you are already on the texting list, then you probably didn't even realize it, that you got text this last week from this number, but you're good. But if you would like, if you have not received text from our church and you would like to, just call Terry this week and let her know, and we'll get you set up. All right, okay, let's see. All right, the soccer registration is open. Last checked, there were 67, but I think we have more coming that will be signing up for soccer, for upward soccer. So keep that in mind. And still trying to nail down a date for it. It will be a Tuesday for the pre-need seminar, but we're trying to get that date together. But keep that in your head, and we'll let you know a date as soon as we have one. Let's see. Oh, next Sunday. Join us as we pray for our school students, teachers, and staff. That's this next Sunday morning. So we'll have them come and we'll pray. We'll have a time of prayer for them. I just can't believe it's about to start again. I can't believe it. I feel like we had summer. When did that happen? Here we are. And then First Kids begins on the first Wednesday in August. So keep that in mind as well. But it is good to be in the house of the Lord with you today. If you are visiting with us, there's a portion of your bulletin we'd love you to fill out. You can just tear that off, fill that out, and place it in our tithes and offering box, which you can find in the foyer. Let's join in together and let us recite or read together our mission statement. You'll find it on the front of your bulletin. All right, here we go. Loving God, loving people, and sharing the message of Jesus Christ. Hopefully, we'll be able to hear from Bob Nelson at some point about how he was able to be a part of sharing the message of Jesus Christ in Brazil. So you'll be looking forward to that. But let's begin our time of worship together this morning.
The psalmist wrote, "My lips shall rejoice when I sing of thee." So let's let our lips rejoice this morning about the majesty and the power of God.
Pray with me. Father, as we come to you today, Lord, we're just thankful that we could be in your house again today, Lord. We just ask you to continue to bless this church and all that we can do. Lord, be with our members, Lord, that are traveling. Give them safe travels back home. Be with those that are home with illnesses and hope they feel better soon. And just be with our members everywhere, Lord, the nursing homes, the hospitals. Just continue to heal them. Lord, as we pray, Lord, we just ask you to, we lift up our country, Lord, and I pray for our leaders and that they will make the decisions that are best for our country. Be with our men and women serving our country all over the world. Protect them. Bring them home safely. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Stay close by my side. Keep your eyes on me. Though this life is hard, I will give you perfect peace. In this time of trial, trust me when I say that
as we move into this time of prayer this morning, I want us to remember those who are in Paris at this moment and who are being a gospel witness there. Concerted efforts every time the Olympics happen. There are concerted efforts by Christians who are near or who may live in the city where the Olympics are being held. And so I want us to pray for those Christians as they share the message of the gospel to those in whom they encounter. A lot of people. It's a heavy burden to have the Olympics. That's why we've never had them here in Winnsboro. But it's a heavy burden on the city, you know. But I do want us to pray for those efforts where the gospel is being shared right there in Paris. Pray that God moves in a mighty way. There are others on your hearts, on your minds, and you will want to lift them up to the Lord. This is the moment. We have this time in the midst of our service every Sunday. I remember hearing somebody say, the old pastoral prayer. Not a lot of churches do that. Well, that's their choice. My choice
our choice, I hope, here is to have this moment, this time where we can lift up to the Lord the burdens that are on us, our concerns that we have for others. This is a moment where we as a body of believers can stop and talk to the Lord. And so I want to encourage you to take this moment to talk to the Lord, and I'll voice a prayer as we do. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you thankful that we can. Lord, we're thankful to be able to live in a country that allows us publicly to be able to go to a place, to come to a place, to worship you freely. We don't have to worry about somebody coming in the building saying, no, you can't do this worship stuff anymore. We don't have to worry about that here. But Lord, we know many countries that are out there that are having great difficulty having to meet in homes to worship, having to meet even in secret, just simply to worship you, to read your word out loud, and to be able to be reminded that they have brothers and sisters that are with them on this journey of becoming more like Jesus. Father, we pray for those who are truthfully risking many times their own lives just to simply worship you. Help us, Father, to understand a little bit better about what they go through and how they live, for we do not know. God, also do not help us to take for granted the freedoms we have. Lord, may we simply be beating down the door to be able to come and to worship you and to sing praises to you and to focus on you and to be able to do it with our brothers and sisters freely. We pray for the gospel witness in Paris. Lord, we pray for those Christians who have been planning for months and months for this time period in which they are going to be available and see all these people coming into town and into the city. Father, we pray for them. Lord, enable them to do their best in sharing your message. Father, we pray for those who are sick, those who are doing poorly, Lord, that you would bring healing to their bodies. Father, that you would reach out your hands of healing and lay a hold of them and hold them close to yourself. Father, we've gathered here in your name to worship you, and I pray that's exactly what takes place today, that we worship you in spirit and in truth with all that we have, Father. We ask these things in the name of the one who is our deliverer, our redeemer, Jesus. Jesus, in his name we pray. Amen.
This morning we sing hymns about trust in God, our faith, and our hope. Let's sing together.
Jesus, the kind shepherd found me, and now I'm on my way home. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
Thank you, Suzanne, John. That's my wife. That just want to point that out. That just want to make sure. I'm the counselor's husband. That's who I am. Wow, fortunate I am. As we move along, as we follow these Israelites. This has been such an exciting time just to watch and to learn from them and to see, what they encountered, what happened to them, how God treated them, how they treated God. But as we join them again on their journey to the Promised Land, we find Moses standing at the edge of the Promised Land. The children of Israel are with him, and the time has come. The time has come for Moses to pass away. Let's join the story in Deuteronomy chapter 34. And if you are able and willing, I ask that you stand in honor of the reading of the Word of God. We're looking at verses 1 through 4. Now, Moses went up from the plains of Moab to Mount Nebo to the top of Pisgah, which is opposite Jericho. And the Lord showed him all the land, Gilead as far as Dan, and all Naphtali and the land of Ephraim and Manasseh and all the land of Judah as far as the western sea and the Negev and the plain in the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees as far as Zoar. Then the Lord said to him, "This is the land which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, saying, I will give it to your descendants. I have let you see it with your eyes, but you shall not go over there." May God bless the reading of His Word to our hearts today. I invite you to be seated. So we see here God showing Moses the Promised Land. Now, the circled area here is the Promised Land. And that is that area in which Moses was able to look over into and see. And so that kind of gives you an idea of where everything is. You see Egypt to the south, southwest, and then you kind of have an idea. Most of us know where Israel is, don't we? By now, if we watch the news at all, if they do show us a map, sometimes they don't show us a map as much anymore, I don't think. But this gives you an idea of that's where our promised land, their promised land is. Let's look at verses 1 through 4 again. God shows Moses the land that he led the people to. He shows them where they're going to live, where they're going to set up their homes. Now, he is pointing over there. He's showing them. He has led them to this promised land. It's a huge, huge accomplishment. I mean, that's a lot of people. Thousands and thousands of people. Here they come, and they're making their way across the plains, you know, making their way from Egypt all the way up that way. Long way to travel. But notice the words again, "But you shall not go over there," God said to Moses. Remember this? Remember back in Numbers 20, verse 12, the Bible said, "But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you have not believed me to treat me as holy in the sight of the sons of Israel, therefore you shall not bring this assembly into the land which I have given them." Remember, Moses had not done as he was instructed to do. God told him to speak to that rock, and he did not. He struck the rock, and water came forth. He had disobeyed God and did not treat him as holy before the people. What it looked like was that Moses hit the rock and water came out. That's what it looked like. What it was supposed to look like was Moses is supposed to speak to the rock and the water is to come forth. And the credit, the willingness to follow the Lord, the obedience of Moses to God was going to be evident, and there it was, but it didn't happen that way. He disobeyed God. He did not treat him as holy before the people. Charles Spurgeon said, God did in effect say to Moses, Thou only have I chosen of all mankind to speak with me face to face, and therefore, since thou hast failed in thy faith after such intercourse with me, it behooves me in very faithfulness and love towards thee to mark thy failure with an evident token of displeasure. Wow. That's a mouthful. We would have said, well, God was disappointed, and he made it clear to Moses, you ain't making it in the promised land. I mean, that's kind of what we would say. But yet Charles Spurgeon, whoa, you know, he's got the words, and so he uses them. But he makes it very clear. Sin does not go unpunished. Even for the man of God, even for Moses here, even for any man or woman of God, anybody in any kind of spot, sin does not go unpunished. Look at verse 5. So Moses, the servant of God, died there in the land of Moab according to the word of the Lord. Wow, that was quick. But you shall not go over there. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died in the land of Moab according to the word of the Lord. He sees the land. There is some satisfaction in seeing that he got them to the point. There is some delight, I think, in Moses' heart that he got them this far. But I also feel there's probably trouble in his heart for having disobeyed God and not making himself ineligible to be able to go into the promised land. But there had to have been some joy as well. The people that he loved, God's people, had made it. And he was the one that got them almost there, right to the edge. He got them that far. Look at verse 6. And he buried him in the land, in the valley, in the land of Moab, opposite Beth Peor. But no man knows his burial place to this day. Now my Bible has the he capitalized. I think that's for a reason. In your version, it may not be capitalized, but it's implied that the he is God. God buried Moses. We don't know where he is. They don't know where he is. They say no man knows his burial place to this day. God took care of his servant, Moses, buried him. It's the best we can tell that happened. God loved Moses. God cared for Moses. God used Moses in a mighty way. And he loved him. His obedience was strong for the Lord and to the Lord. And yet, even leaders like that can slip, can fall, can fail, can falter. Look at verse 7. Although Moses was 120 years old when he died, his eye was not dim nor his vigor abated. He was strong still. He could see well still at 120. Amazing. But he could see well. It was not because of his age that he died. It was because of his sin that he died. The people were going to go over into the promised land. Moses couldn't go because Moses had sinned. That would leave Moses outside of the promised land. I think we see a loving God here. I think we see a God who is not going to punish him even more by holding him outside of the promised land and letting him see how wonderful it is from a distance. That's not what God's doing. God says it's time to come home. And Moses dies. Look at verse 8. So the sons of Israel wept for Moses and the plains of Moab 30 days. Then the days of weeping and mourning for Moses came to an end. They loved Moses. Oh, they grumbled against him many times. Many times they were upset because there's no water here. What are we going to eat? You've left us, you brought us out here in the middle of nowhere to die, Moses. But they did love Moses. There was a care for him. He was their leader. He was the one chosen by God to lead them to that promised land. So they did have a respect for him. He had led them out of Egypt. He had intervened on their behalf. He had ensured their survival in this wilderness. His life was lived before God in obedience to him and in fellowship with him. There was, in fact, none like Moses, neither before nor after, whether as a prophet or a powerful leader, until the coming of the one who was more than a prophet. And you could probably guess his name. Jesus. Yes. Moses is one to be remembered. Moses is one to be looked to. Moses was not able to see the plan for the people carried out in its fullness. He did not get to see them. He did not get to be there when they all entered into the land flowing with milk and honey. I would have loved to have seen that. I would have loved to have seen that. Now, don't get me wrong. I wouldn't have wanted to be one of the children of Israel during all that time. That was a lot of ups and downs, a lot of... Well, interesting, huh? We too have ups and downs in our lives, even today. And some of those ups and downs are with God. And so I don't know that it would have been all that different. You know, the people of Israel didn't know about television. They didn't know about the internet. They didn't know about phones and cell phones and all that kind of stuff. So I very well could have been there with them and been one of them. But oh, the joy to enter into the promised land. Oh, the joy to be able to flood with the rest of my brothers and sisters, to just flood into that land. And Moses has been a part of preparing the way for me. You and I have a role in preparing this church for the future. We are a microcosm, a small part of the bigger family of God, and you and I have a part of preparing this church for the future. We may not all get to see what God does with it in the future, but we're handing on the work and the witness of this body of believers, and we're going to need some people to hand it to, and we're going to need to have something of value to give to them. This family of God, there's another generation coming if Jesus tarries long enough, and you and I need to have something of value to give this next generation. This church is going to look different in the future. Oh, yeah, it's probably going to look different. The style of music that is sung may change, but the message of the music will never change. The preacher will change, but the message of the Bible will never change. We must make sure that happens, and that's up to those who are going to come after us, those who may be sitting among us even now who are going to be part of the next generations. And we need to make sure that the gospel message is held in high regard and that it is shared and that it's the Bible that's preached from the pulpit. Nothing else. Nothing else. God's word preached from this pulpit. The faces of the congregation will change. I pray there will be new faces, beautiful faces that will take their place. This church family has lost many who established it and made it into the church that it is. Some of you are still here, and I thank God for that. But we're not all going to be here forever. Our concern is that at this moment is to reach those who will be the next ones who will sit in these pews and carry on the work and witness of First Baptist Church Winnsboro. We've lost several members, and I started putting them in my sermon, and I had planned to name them all. And I thought, it's just too many. Too many who were part of crafting who we are as First Baptist Church. Too many who sat in a place of teaching Sunday school, who sat in a nursery, who served on a committee, and who were part of making this church who it is. so many that I thought, I can't read them all. There's just too many. I had them. I had the list. And I thought, good night. So many that had a vital role to play. People who drove buses for youth trips. People who led youth. People who were part of the choir, who led choir, who people who led congregational music, who were part of crafting who this church is. And we need people to take our place. And so as this transition in the life of Moses is taking place, so also transitions happen in the life of a church. And there will be a day I'm not here. Whether I pass on while I'm here or whether God moves me, but there will be a time of transition. And there will be transition times for many of us where we leave this place we've called home, and we go to our eternal home. And we reacquaint ourselves with all those who've gone before us. And we look and we start looking, and if I start naming names, I'll leave somebody out, so I don't want to do that. But in my head, I'm thinking of some people that I'm going to be looking for when I leave this place. And I'm going to look for them and find them, and I'm going to say, look, we made it. I'm here, I made it. Not because of anything I did, but because of everything that Jesus did. We have a role, you and I, to play in the future of God's people here in Winnsboro. We have a role to play. And we've got to find our role. We've got to know what we're doing and be a part of bringing this body of believers to that edge of going into the promised land of heaven. And we've got to do our role, fulfill our role. The second thing we see, Joshua is mentioned as the next leader. Look at verse 9. Now Joshua, the son of Nun, was filled with the spirit of wisdom. For Moses had laid his hands on him, and the sons of Israel listened to him and did as the Lord had commanded Moses. There was a transition that was taking place, and Moses was a big part of that transition. He was able to name, or not name, but he was able to place his hands on the next leader. This Joshua, it says, was filled with the spirit of wisdom. Oh boy, that's what we need. A spirit of wisdom for all of us. All of us need a spirit of wisdom inside of us. God had all this planned out. Joshua was going to be the one who was leading his people into the promised land, God's people into the promised land. It's going to be Joshua doing the deed. Notice he was filled with that spirit of wisdom. Again, what is wisdom? We have to define it, I think. It's good to reacquaint ourselves with the definition of wisdom, because sometimes people think, well, you know, that fellow over there, he's got a lot of years on him. I bet he's got a lot of wisdom. He might. He might not. What is wisdom? Wisdom is the ability to utilize knowledge and experience with common sense and insight. Wisdom is the ability to take the knowledge, utilize the knowledge and the experience with common sense and insight. These people that have the spirit of wisdom, these who have great wisdom that you have encountered, many times they're not people that run their mouths all the time. Many times they are the ones... who are what I call the processors. The people who process. The people who look and watch and see what's happening in the world around them. They're watching how people act. They're watching how people behave. They're learning from what they're seeing. And then they're applying that in simple and numerous ways in their own life. And it's like, wow. How did they know how to do that? Well, how did they know? Well, that was really smart. Yeah, we say things like that. And these are the people that stop and think about things and process things and weigh things and say, well, you know what? Huh, I wonder why that person did that way. Why did this person do it this way? I see a favorable response in the way they did it this way. I see an unfavorable response in the way they did it. I might, if I do this, do it this way. Because they got a favorable response. Not because, oh, you got people were pleased, but because it was done well in a right manner in which it didn't cause turmoil and chaos. Do you get what I'm saying? People with wisdom do not start chaos. People with wisdom do things in a way that is what we would just say smart. They do things in a way that is beneficial to as many as they can, as it can be beneficial to. In other words, they seek to be fair, knowing that not everybody's going to be happy all of the time, and we can't please everybody all the time. But the ones with wisdom take time to weigh out matters. How can we do this in a spirit of unity? How can we do what we're doing in a spirit of peace? How can that happen? Those are the people with wisdom. That's how they think. That's how they act. This is Joshua. He is filled with the spirit of wisdom. What a wonderful thing to be filled with. Notice the sons of Israel listened to him and did as the Lord had commanded Moses. Wow. Wow. They listened. They respected this Joshua as the next leader. They listened to him and they obeyed him. They had made the transition to Joshua as a leader. They had accepted his leadership under the guidance of God. That can only occur when there is a level of trust between the people and God and the people and their leader. Otherwise, it doesn't work. Otherwise, it doesn't work. If there's no trust level between you and your pastor, not much is going to happen. You don't trust your pastor, not much is going to happen. You trust the Lord? If the Lord God has led your pastor to your church and you believe that, well then, there it is. And you've got to deal with it. And you've got to pray for him. And you've got to decide, well, blast it, I've seen other pastors I like better, but I got stuck with this one. Oh, well, yeah, you did. But what can you do? You can lift him up in prayer. Yes. You can come before the very throne of God and you can say, God, help my pastor. Help him, Lord. Give him a spirit of wisdom. Help him to see what needs to be done. Father, help him. And you as a body of believers can talk to the Lord and God can work on that pastor. Yes. And he can make him what he needs to be. But there's got to be that level of trust there. Joshua's a great leader, but he still doesn't hold a candle to Moses. And now this is exactly what happens in many churches, but a Baptist church in particular, because that's what I'm familiar with. Oh, well, you know, we look at a pastor that comes in, we say, well, he's not as good as so-and-so. You know, so brother so-and-so, we liked him better. Why does that happen? Because you're comparing that one to the one you know. It's a simple comparison. I'm not faulting anybody for doing that. That happens. We look and say, well, they were better. Well, yeah, well, allow the new guy to show himself. Allow the new guy to prove himself and pray for him. And remember that God gave him to you. There it is, you know. That's what God did. And so if that's what God did, well, then there must be a good reason behind it. Because God's not going to make a mistake. God is not dumb. God is not going to go, oops, oh, I shouldn't have let that person go there. Well, preacher, what about those churches that have issues with the pastor? And that pastor's got issues. That pastor's got issues. Sometimes maybe even the group or the committee that brought him, maybe they didn't listen close enough to the Lord. Maybe they got panicky. Maybe they thought, oh no, we got to have somebody quick. Oh, you're called to be a pastor. Oh, okay, come on. We'll let you be the pastor. Whoa. We do have to be careful. But Joshua, yeah, he doesn't hold a candle to Moses, but look at verse 10. Since that time, no prophet has risen in Israel like Moses. Now, wow, it gets to be put in black and white. Whom the Lord knew face to face. God had a different kind of relationship with Moses. He had a different kind of relationship with Moses. He has a relationship with Joshua, but he has a different kind of relationship with Moses. One that he says the Lord knew face to face. There's something about that. In short, he was God's chosen charismatic leader in Israel. Look at verses 11 and 12. For all the signs and wonders which the Lord sent him to perform in the land of Egypt against Pharaoh and all his servants and all his land, and for all the mighty power and for all the great terror which Moses performed in the sight of Israel. Since that time, no prophet has risen like Moses. He was God's chosen leader, God's spokesman, God's agent. In him, in Moses, was concentrated all the great offices of Israel. Prophet, ruler, judge, priest. If some held these offices, you know, if there were some that held these offices later, but nobody like Moses. Moses was the greatest of them all. Being filled with the spirit of wisdom is something we know that we can pray for. Moses had wisdom. Joshua had wisdom. We know that we can pray for that. How do we know that? Because James chapter 1 verses 5 through 8 tells us this. But if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. Notice this is something we can be sure of. We know that God will give us wisdom. God, give me wisdom in this decision. Help me, O Lord. And God says, I will. I will help you. You've asked me and I will help. How many times have you asked God to help you in a decision that you have to make? Please go to him. Please go to him first. But please go to him if you don't go to him first. Please go to him. God, what do I need to do? Ask him. He will let you know. We need to pray for wisdom. We need to be open. We need to be open to the voice of God. What do we need to do to have a church to pass on to the next generation? We need to ask God, what do we need to do? What do we need to do, Father? Ask him. He will let us know. But he must ask in faith without any doubting. This is verse 6 of James chapter 1. But he must ask in faith without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. Well, I'll ask God, but I don't think he's going to give me an answer. What kind of attitude is that to have with the Almighty God, the ruler of the universe? Well, I'll ask him, but I don't know if he'll help me. Wow. Wow, I'm not seeing trust being displayed in a statement like that. I'm not seeing leaning on the Lord in a statement like that. Look, he says, but he must ask in faith without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. No, if we ask God, we must ask in faith. We must drop it right there. That's one of the things I've been learning myself, is to drop something at the feet of God and say, okay, there it is. God, I'm asking. I'm letting you deal with this. I've got my ears on. I'm listening. I'm waiting. I'm wanting to know what I need to do, but I'm not going to force you, try to push you to give me an answer. I have asked you. I'm letting it sit here, and I know in faith that you're going to respond. You're just going to do it. I know you are, because you love me and you're listening to me. It may not be today, it may not be tomorrow, it may not be next week, but I'm going to leave it with you and know that you're going to handle it. I have to. That's all I have. That's all I have. This makes perfect sense. If you're asking the ruler of the universe to do something, you should in fact ask in faith. You should ask him knowing that you're speaking to the one who knows all, the one who sees all, the one who can do all. That's who you're talking to. Have you ever had to talk to an authority in any way, in any point in your life? Maybe that authority, maybe you had to talk to a senator about something. Maybe you had to talk to a lawyer about something. Maybe you had to talk to somebody who was in a form of leadership about something, a mayor, a police chief, a sheriff. Maybe there was something you had to discuss and you kind of were like, oh boy, this is, they can do something. I'm going to go talk to them. And you go and you talk to them, and what do you expect? You expect something to happen. Why? Because they're in a spot of leadership, and that's where they are, and they have the authority, and they have the power to do something. And that's how you approach them, and that's how you talk to them. And you walk away thinking something's going to be done. Well, why is it that we can't approach God in the same way?
That's
what has happened to us if we think that, well, I'll just ask him. You know, I don't really want to bother him. You know, I'll just ask God and maybe he'll answer and maybe he'll do something. Why do we have such an attitude like that? If we're approaching the God of the universe, the all-powerful, almighty God with something, we should expect an answer. We should expect something to happen. We should not approach with all doubt in our mind and say, well, I don't know. God, if you have time. God, if you can. It'd be really nice, Lord, if you would. You know, God, I really don't know what to do in this situation, so maybe you could help me. No. No, you approach the throne boldly. Only because of what Jesus did for you are you able to approach the throne of grace boldly. But you approach it and you say, dear God, I need help. I'm coming to you because you are Almighty God. You know all. You can do all. You are all powerful, Father. And I'm asking you, Father, I need your help. I need your help. And you come with expectation that something will be done. Look, we're living in an age where there is no more room for faithless Christians when it comes to talking to God. We don't have time. We don't have time like that. There's no room for Christians who are saying, well, maybe God will help me. I just don't know. No, we need to be strong in this day and age. You and I need to be such obvious examples of children of God. We are to be the ones who are following him and leaning on him in every situation, talking with him, begging with him, asking him for help. The one who doubts, the one who's driven and tossed by the wind, the wishy-washy one, for that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord. Being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. So what is the Bible saying? Don't expect to get anything. If you don't expect him to do something and you come to him and ask, well, don't expect to get much. You know, don't come to him, oh, well, God, if you could, take care of that, thanks. All right, thanks. Does it really sound like you really believe he could do that? Do you believe it? If you believe it, ask him in faith. Ask him boldly. Lord, I need help. Help me now. With expectation that you will receive an answer. You will receive from him. As we move forward as a church, we must trust in God. We must follow his leadership above our whims and preferences. Whoa. In order to have something of value to pass on to the next generation. Yeah, I got my preferences. And I prefer something different. What we need to prefer, what we need to have in our preferences, is the preference that this church will continue. And this church will be a church of work and witness in this community. That's what our preference should be, is that we continue into the next generation, into the next generation. Until Jesus comes. I mean, I'm no idiot. He could come tomorrow. I know that. But as far as you and I are concerned, when we look at Moses, how he led the people up to the edge of the promised land, and then here's Joshua, the next leader, to lead them into that promised land. You and I, we need to be ready to help and to train and to assimilate people into the body of Christ so that we have a next generation of this church. His leadership must be followed. God's leadership. Let us consistently pray for wisdom in all the decisions we make here. Let us be careful to honor God in all that we say and do. Oh yeah, we got preferences, but what does God want? What does God want? Let us be heard in our community as the people. Let us be heard about in our community as the people of God who follow him closely. Let people be talking about us, not because we're great, but because they've noticed we're following the Lord. Let us be known as the people who follow God, the ones who are reaching out beyond the walls of a building, who are reaching out beyond 502 Highland Street, who are reaching out and saying, look, God loves you and we want you to know. Let us be known for that as the people of God at Highland and Moore Street. We have a role to play in the future of God's people here in Winnsboro, and we must ask God for wisdom in every decision we make as we move forward. Every decision we make needs to be prayed about, prayed over. And we need to say, God, what is it that you want of us? We need to ask Him that. What is it, God, that you want of us? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you. Lord, we see your people as they were courageously led to that point, to right up to the promised land, Father, by your servant Moses. And Father, we watched today and we saw that he died and you buried him. But you had someone else. You had someone else ready. And Joshua was there. And you worked through Joshua. And the next generation of your people began to move and to live with you and have their being on this earth. And they were there as your people, shining your light in the world. Father, remind us that we are your people. We are to shine the light as well. Father, help us to do that. Help us. Lord, I pray if there's somebody here this morning, maybe there's somebody here that's never given their heart to you. Maybe there's somebody today that just says, look, I've not made that decision to follow Jesus. I've not asked him to forgive me of my sins. He is not in charge of my life, but I want that. Maybe today you need to give your heart to him. We're going to have a time of response in just a few moments. And as we sing, would you come? Maybe today's the day for you. Maybe you're here and you have a deep concern for a friend or a relative who does not know who Jesus is. Maybe you need to come and just pray for that person. Maybe you feel comfortable standing there in your own area there this morning and praying for them. But would you do that? Pray for them. Father, thank you for your great love for us. Thank you for leading us. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to sing a hymn of response. Out of my bondage, sorrow, and night. Let's stand together. You come as the Lord leads you to come, would you?
Out of my bondage, sorrow, and night, Jesus, I come. Jesus, I come. Into thy freedom, gladness, and
as you leave this place today, I'm praying for you to have wisdom in all the decisions you make, whether big or small. I'm going to ask the Lord to give you wisdom in making those decisions. I love you, and it's good to see your loving faces here in this place today. May the Lord bless you as you leave and keep you safe. You're dismissed.